And that fear of your books falling down on you and crushing you is real, because there's no way I'm holding all these for the thumbnail, but October stack. Wait for it. November stack.
Yikes.
It's a lot, I know. Whoa. Sorry. Alright, so without further ado, let's go ahead and jump into our October book haul, because there is a lot that I got in October as well as I got in November, so please bear with me, you guys. It's a lot of books. I'm gonna just grab the ones that are available to me that I got in October. Alright, the first one I'm gonna hold up because it's not in a pile and it won't fall down and crush me, but I picked up the Capturing the Devil to Stalking Jack the Ripper series by Carrie Maniscalco, I think. I'm so sorry if I butchered that. I try not to, but sometimes words are hard. But that is this one. We all know Stalking Jack the Ripper series. And when I get to this one, yes. So I'm going to read the inside to give a description. If you haven't heard about Capturing the Devil, it's been floating around a little bit this year, but she swore she couldn't live without him. The devil is pleased to comply. Audrey Rose Wadsworth and Thomas Cresswell have arrived in America, a bold, brash land bursting with life. But their beloved London, the city of Chicago, has dark secrets. When the two attend the spectacular World's Fair, they uncover a sickening truth. The once-in-a-lifetime event is tainted with reports of missing people, unsolved murders. Audrey Rose and Thomas begin their investigations only to find themselves facing a serial killer unlike any they've encountered before. Identifying him is one thing, but capturing him, especially within the infamous murder hotel he built as a confusing and terrifying torture lair, is another. Well, will Audrey Rose, together with her true love at last, see her final mystery to its end? Or will she fall prey to her most cunning advisory yet? I don't know if I said the last part correctly, but oh, I can't wait to get to this one after I get through the second and third book. But this is the fourth one in the series, if you guys didn't know that. Just look at that cover. Woo! Alright, we're moving on. The other book that I got that has me intrigued, it's, I don't know if it's exactly gonna be like the TV show, but it's the book of the TV show, and that is Riverdale, The Maple Murderers. Yes. The Maple Man is coming for you. Riverdale is teeming with excitement over the news that an old town tradition is suddenly being revived, the Riverdale Revels. But Archie, Betty, Jughead, and Veronica find the whole thing suspicious. If the festival dates back to town's first successful maple taping, why is there no records of the revels anywhere? Then, on the night of the festival, a skeleton is uncovered in a 75-year-old time capsule. Ooh, creepy. And accidents keep befalling the contests of the Royal Maple Pageant, including some of the gang's friends. Is someone clearly trying to put an end to the revels once and for all? But who? And more importantly, why? And that is this book. It sounds super good, and if you love Riverdale like I do, these books are, they sound really amazing. I haven't started them yet, but I have all of them now. So definitely check them out if you're interested. And I'm not going to give a synopsis for this one because it's been around for a little while, and we all know Harry Potter and the Goblet of Fire, right? I mean, it's been a long time since I've reread Harry Potter series, but all you need to know is that Harry Potter is a wizard. He didn't know he was a wizard when we first heard about the world, but that's all I'm going to sum up on Harry Potter, I'm sorry. But if it sounds interesting, here's how to falter. And he's got three best friends. Ron, or no, he's got two best friends, not three. Wow. Like I said, it's been forever since I've been into Harry Potter, so please forgive me for that last comment there. We're gonna set that one. moving on from Harry Potter. We are going to be talking about The Tunnel of Bones by Victoria Schwab. This follows a girl named Cassidy who has a ghost friend named Jacob, and her parents are running like a little TV show where they're hunting down for ghosts, but little do they know, their daughter can see into the second veil. And isn't that ironic when you're hunting down ghosts? But trouble is haunting Cassidy Blake even more than usual. She, plus her ghost friend Jacob, is in Paris, where Cass's parents are filming their show about the world's most haunted cities. Sure, it's fun eating croissants and seeing the Eiffel Tower, but there's true ghostly dark danger lurking beneath Paris, in the creepy underground catacombs. Ooh, that does sound creepy. When Cass awakens a frighteningly strong spirit, she must rely on her still developing skills. Wow, that's a tongue twister. As a ghost hunter, and turns to friends both old and new to help her unravel a mystery. But time is running out, and the spirit is only growing stronger. If Cass fails, the force she's unleashed could haunt the city forever. And this is also a middle grade book, as well as the first one, which is City of Ghosts, and you should definitely check them both out because the first one's amazing. I haven't gotten to this one yet, but I plan to, I think, next year for sure. The first one was great. Alright, the next one I'm going to talk about, which I don't know a whole lot about, but it sounds really good. I've seen it on people's channels every now and again, and that is The School for Good and Evil, and I believe it's also another middle grade book, and it's by Soman I'm not gonna even try, but it's this one. This year's best friends, Sophie and Agatha, are about to discover where all the lost children go. The fabled school for good and evil, where ordinary boys and girls are trained to be fairy tale heroes and villains. As the most beautiful girl in Gavilonda, Sophie has dreamed of being kidnapped into an enchanted world her whole life. With her pink dresses, glass slippers, and devotion to good deeds, she knows she'll earn top marks at the school for good and graduate a storybook princess. Meanwhile, Agatha, with her shapeless black frocks, a wicked pet cat, and dislike of nearly everyone, seems a natural fit for the school of evil. But when the two girls are swept into the endless woods, they find their fortunes reversed, and they'll quickly find that the only one way out of a fairy tale is to live through it. This also sounds super good, which is also why I picked it up. Alright. Need a drink. Refreshing. Alright, the next book I picked up is Night of Cake and Puppets by Lanny Taylor. It's a little novella to Daughter of Smoke and Bones, the series, which next year we're making it a priority, and then we can squeeze this book in there. Ooh, and when you look at the end pages, ooh! I guess I didn't see that part, but look at it naked! And then look at those end papers, they're gorgeous! Oh, love it. I don't know if there's anything on the back. Oh my goodness, it's a good thing I looked because look at that! What? I'm so stoked right now. I didn't realize it had something on the back too. Alright. Life doesn't need magic to be magical. Ooh. But a little bit sure doesn't hurt. Okay? Petite though she may be, Susanna is not known for her timidity. Okay. Her best friend Karu calls her rabbit fairy, her voodoo eyes are said to freeze blood, and even her older brother fears her wrath. But when it comes to simple matter of talking to her crush, Mick, also known as a violin boy, her courage deserts her. Now enough is enough. Susanna is determined to seize the night, and she has a fistful of magic and a plan. It's a wonderful, elaborate treasure hunt of a plan that will make Mick all over Prak on a cold winter's night, before finally leading him into the treasure herself. Violin Boy is not going to know what hits him. And that is A Night of Cake and Puppets. It's a treasure map, and the treasure, there she is, in the center of the page. The X marks the spot. Susanna is the treasure. Oh, good luck with that. And that is this book. Just look how gorgeous it is. I like the pink and the purple. The pink and the blue. But there's a little bit of purple in it, though. I like that. Okay. I'm moving on. The next one we're going to be talking about is The Grace Year by Kim Leggett. Some of these authors' names are hard to say. Ooh. Took the dust jacket off, and it looks like that. Down the spine. The lovely in pages. You can barely see that with the light. But we try. Alright. And what this one's about. We'll just take the dust jacket off, because apparently it doesn't want to stay on the book. Alright. No one speaks of the grace year. It is forbidden. In Gardner County, girls are told they have the power to lure grown men from their beds to drive women mad with jealousy. They believe their very skin emits a powerful apoptosis, the potent essence of youth, of a girl on the ledge of a womanhood. That's why they're banished for their 16th year to release their magic into the wild so they can return purified and ready for marriage. But not all of them will make it home alive. 16-year-old Tyranny James dreams of a better life and a society that doesn't pit friend against friend or woman against woman. But as her own grace year draws near, she quickly realizes that it's not just the brutal elements they must fear. It's not even the poachers in the woods, men who are waiting for a chance to grab one of the girls in order to make a fortune on the black market. Their greatest threat may very well be each other. And that is the Gracier. It sounds super good. And now I'm putting the dust jacket back on the book since it fell off. Rude. Alright, the other book, I was so excited that I ordered it from Amazon, and it's got this pretty little maroon ribbon, and it is The Near Witch by V.E. Schwab. I think this is her very first book she published. I'm not sure if I'm correct or not, but let me know down in the comments. That would be great. And just look at those end pages and then check it out. Ah, we love stuff like that on this channel. Anyway, The Near Witch is only an old story to frighten children. If the wind calls at night, you must not listen. The wind is lonely and always looking for company. There are no strangers in the town of Near. These are the truths that Lexi has heard all her life. But when an actual stranger, a boy who seems to fade like smoke, appears outside her home on the moor at night, she knows that at least one of these sayings is no longer true. The next night, the children of Near start disappearing from their beds, and the mysterious boy falls under suspicion. As the hunt for the children intensifies, so does Lexi. Lexi needs to know about the witch that might be more than a bedtime story. But the wind that seems to speak through the walls at night, and about the history of this nameless boy. That sounds super good. And it sounds like it could be more of like a Halloween book. That's even better. Alright, the next book I'm going to talk about is Uprooted by Naomi Novovic. I hope I said that correctly. But I seen this kind of around on Goodreads, so Goodreads made me get it. I'm not even sure how you say your name. Agnesa loves her valley home in a quiet village, but the corrupted wood stands on the border, full of power, and its shadow lies over her life. Her people rely on the cold-driven wizard known only as the dragon to keep the woods dark forces at bay, but he demands a terrible price for his assistance. Every 10 years, one young woman must be handed over to serve him without questions. The next choosing is fast approaching, and Agnesa knows everyone knows that the dragon will take Kiesa, beautiful, graceful, brave Kiesa, all the things Kansia isn't, and her dearest friend in the world, and there is no one to save her. But when the dragon comes, it's not Kasia he will choose. Ah, sounds good, and sounds like it's a dragon book. Your girl likes dragons. I don't know how many times I have to say it on the channel, but sign me up. We like that. The next one I'm going to talk about is a cute little graphic novel, and it is Teen Titans Raven by Gammy Garcia. She was the one who helped co-wrote the Beautiful Creature series. So when I seen she had her own little comic book, had to check it out because I love the Beautiful Creature series. Alright. When a tragic accident takes the life of a 17-year-old Raven Ross foster mom, and Raven's memory, she moves to New Orleans to recover and finish her senior year of high school. Starting over isn't easy. Raven remembers everyday stuff like how to solve math equations and make pasta, but she can't remember her favorite song or who she was before the accident. And when the impossible things start happening, Raven begins to think it might even be better not to know who she was before. But as she grows closer to her new friends, her foster sister, Max and Tommy Torres, a guy who accepts her for who she is now, Raven has to decide if she's ready to face what's buried in the past and the darkness building inside her. That sounds really good. And just look how cute the illustrations are. Like, I can't wait to get into this very, very soon. And just, yes. I lie and say we're almost done, but we're not. The next book I picked up was The 10,000 Doors of January by Alex E. Harrow. Now, I've heard a couple of people talk about this, and it has the deckled edges. I just said that wrong, but it has those kind of edges in the books. I love these edges in the books. Alright. When one enters a door, one must be brave enough to see the other side. In a spiraling mansion filled with peculiar treasures, January Scaler is a curiosity herself. As the ward of the wealthy Mr. Locke, she feels a little different from the artifacts that decorate the halls. Carefully maintained, largely ignored, and utterly out of place. Then she finds a strange book, a book that carries the scent of the other world and tells a tale of secret doors, of love, adventure, and danger. Each page turn reveals impossible truths about the world of January, and January discovers a story increasingly intertwined with your own. Step into the world of January Scholar in Alex E. Harrow's Spellbinding Debet. I said that completely wrong. Ooh, I'm loving the spine though. It's got a key on that. I love that. And that is the 10,000 Doors of January. I've heard definitely good things about this book, and if it definitely sounds good, pick it up and just look how gorgeous the cover is. Oh no, my battery's flashing at me. I'll be back later. Bye-bye. Alright, we're back into the October book haul. Got interrupted by the battery flashing. But the other one I did pick up, I'm gonna make sure this is the right, please hold. Okay, never mind, I did get it this time. The next book I picked up was The End and Other Beginnings by Veronica Roth. And the book looks like that on both sides and on the inside as well. But No world is like the other. Within this masterful collection, each setting is more strange and wonderful than the last, brimming with new technologies and beginnings. And yet, for all the advantages in these futuristic lands, the people still must confront deeply human problems. In these six short stories, Veronica Roth reaches into the unknown and draws forth something starring, familiar, and profoundly beautiful. In Intria, friends Claire and Matt stop speaking 6 months ago. When Matt gets into a car accident and his end looks certain, he requests a visitation, a produce that allows him and Claire to revisit shared memories, and a chance to discover what went wrong. The Spinners follows bounty hunter Alitli Kent as she tracks and kills leeches, a predatory extraterrestrial race that illegally absorbs human host bodies, but death begets death, and Adelphi is relentless in her search for revenge. Imagine a unique sympathy, a slow ode of aches and joy, notes created by each body as it lives and as it dies. In Herkners, these songs are heard by a selected few as Daria makes a difficult decision between her role as a record of life songs or death songs. She discovers where to merge. Vim and Vigor explore fandom, anxiety, and female friendship through Eddie's choice to use the Eglication Protocol? I have no idea. A simulated reality technology that reveals the likely outcomes of difficult decisions, words. In Armored Ones, Tikka has one mission while working undercover with the storyteller. Kill Syra Novrik. Akos, on the other hand, must prove his wits and mettle in rites that will likely kill him. There's more on the back. We're not reading more on the back. But that is the description for The End and Other Beginnings by Veronica Roth. And after all of that, wow. Lemonade is good to have there. Alright. The next one I'm going to talk about that I picked up from a library haul, which is Blood Magic by Tessa Granton. I have one other book by her that I've read partway through. Kind of liked it, kind of not. I didn't end up finishing it, but I have my bookmark in the page where I left off, so one of these days I'll get around to rereading it again. But I will read what this one is about. I dug my pocket knife out of my jeans and flipped open the blade, resting the tip against my left thumb. I paused. My stomach twisted as I contemplated how much it was going to hurt. What if this spell book was a huge joke? Was I crazy to even try? Magic couldn't be real. But it was written in Dad's hand, and he had never been that kind of mean. And he wasn't crazy. No matter what anybody said, Dad had believed in this. And I believe in Dad. I had to. Either way, it was just a drop of blood. I pushed the knife against my skin, puckering it, but not breaking through. My whole body shivered. I was about to find out if magic was real. The electric thrill of terror was sharp on my tongue. I cut deep. Now this definitely sounds super good. And I think I found Halloween Reed. Oh, I didn't get it at the library. My bad. But it came from a library because of how it's all put together. But yay. Alright. The other book I'm going to talk about, because this was definitely a cover by, and it also says it's soon to be a Netflix original series, so whenever I get that back, gonna check it out once I get around to reading it, and that is Cursed, written by Thomas Wheeler, and just look how gorgeous this is. Wait for it. There's a sword on the side. Oh! I didn't know it was on the back too. That is so cool! And the spine looks pretty cool. And the end page has got a sword. I bet the back does too. Look at that. I was right. Love when I'm right. Alright, let's get into the description for Cursed. Whosoever wields the sword of power shall be the one true king. But what if the sword has chosen a queen? I'm liking this already. Numi grew up an outcast. Her connection to dark magic and her something to be feared in Druid Village, and that made her desperate to leave. That is until Red Paladin slaughter her entire village, and Nemu's fate is forever altered. Charged by her dying mother to reunite an ancient sword with a legendary sorcerer, Naomi is now her people's only hope. Her mission leaves little room for revenge, but the growing power within her can think of nothing else. Excuse me. Naomi teams up with a charming menacery named Arthur and a refugee fray folk from across England. She wields a sword meant for the one true king and battles paladins and the armies of a corpse ruler. She struggles to unite her people, avenge her family, and discover the truth about her destiny. And perhaps the one thing that can change destiny itself, found at the edge of a blade. Like, if that doesn't sound good, I don't know what does, but also definitely a cover by. You guys should definitely check it out. And there's some, like, illustrations in this as well, which makes it even cooler. Like, look at that. Oh, I'm obsessed with this book. I haven't even read it yet, you guys. Oh. Definitely pick this up, because I think I'm gonna start it maybe next year? We'll see. We'll see. We'll see what happens. Alright. The next book I'm gonna talk about. I've already read it, but I'm gonna do a wrap-up for it soon. Because it wasn't my favorite book. I liked it. But like I'm saying now, it wasn't my favorite. But I might give it a reread because I'm still holding on to it for now. So, yeah, there's that. And that would be The Beautiful by Renee Adonai. I don't know if I said that correctly, but don't get me wrong, I liked it. It's set in 1872 New Orleans City, and then she moves to, she's from Paris, and where did she move to? It's like New York? No, it's not New York. I say New York. Wow. Does it have something on the... Oh, it does kind of have something on the... You can barely see it, but there is a design on there. This book... It has vampires in it, but it's not technically evolved around vampires, if that makes sense. But apparently when she moves to this new town, trouble still follows her, finds her, and she ends up going around with this one cop guy who she kind of wants to get close with, and then something bad happens to him. But that's all I'm going to say, because it's not a wrap-up, and if you haven't read The Beautiful, you might like it. But like I'm saying, it is in 1872, New Orleans is a city ruled by the dead. But to 17-year-old Celine Rousseau, not even sure how to say that last name, New Orleans is a safe haven after she's forced to flee her life as a dressmaker in Paris. Okay, so she's goes, that's what happened. Okay, that's the part I didn't really understand. She's from Paris, but goes to New Orleans. That's what it is. And then, like I said, a lot of stuff goes down there. But there is a couple of murders that go on. But, and where the price of forbidden love is her life. At once a sultry romance and a decent thrilling mystery, master story, of Renée Adier remarks on her most potent fantasy series yet. I don't know, it sounds good, but like I said, I've already read this one, so I really don't want to give a description for The Beautiful. I'm sorry, but hint, not sorry. No, just because. Okay, we're gonna put that one down. We're gonna stop talking about The Beautiful. Just because. I didn't say that. Don't come at me. The next book I really want to talk about, this one, I like this one, and that is The Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. This is her first adult fantasy, not young adult fantasy, so definitely keep that in mind when you're going to picking this one up. Galaxy Alex Stern is the most unlikely member of Yale's freshman class. Raised in Los Angeles, Hitcherlands by a hippie mom, Alex dropped out of school early and into a world of shady drug dealer boyfriends, dead-end jobs, and much, much worse. In fact, by age 20, she is the sole survivor of a horrific, unsolved, multiple homicidal. Some might say she's thrown her life away, but at her hospital bed, Alex is offered a second chance to attend one of the world's most prestigious universities on a full ride. Oh, what's the catch? And why her? Still searching for answers, Alex arrives in New Haven, tasked by her mysterious benefactors with monitoring the activities of Yale's secret societies. Their 8 windowless tomes are well known for haunts of the rich and powerful, from high-ranking politicos to Wall Street's biggest players, but their occult activities are more sinister and more extraordinary than any paranoid imagination might conceive. They tamper with forbidden magic, they raise the dead, and sometimes they prey on the living. And that, my friends, is Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. And I'm telling you now, it is super good. Definitely put this on your Christmas list. See what I did there? Alright, the other book I picked up is Call Down the Hawk by Maggie Stiefvater, and it's the first book in the Dreamer trilogy. Haven't read The Raven Boys yet. I have the old books. Seeing this was somewhat after that series, so I had to get it because I plan on reading The Raven Boys this month. Fingers crossed, but here we are. And this is what had me. The dreamers walk among us, and so do the dreamed. Those who dream cannot stop dreaming. They can only try to control it. Those who are dreamed cannot have their own lives. They will sleep forever if their dreamers die. And then there are those who are drawn to the dreamers, to use them, to trap them, to kill them before their dreams destroy us all. Rowan Lynch is a dreamer. He can pull both curiosities and claustrophobes out of his dreams and into his co-promised reality. Jordan Hennessy is a thief. The closer she becomes to the dream object she is after, the more inextricable she becomes tied to it. Carmen Faroque Lane is a hunter. Her brother was a dreamer and a killer. She has seen what dreaming can do to a person, and she has seen the damage that dreamers can do. But that is nothing compared to the destruction that is about to be unleashed. That sounds really good. I'm kind of getting Strange the Dreamer vibes a little bit on this book. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I don't think I am. At least we're gonna play like I'm not wrong. Alright, the last and final book I have to talk about that I picked up in October is White Space, book one of The Dark Passages by Issa J. Bick. She's the author of the Ashes trilogy. And this I did pick up from the library, as you can tell. Alright. Emma Lindsay's got problems. A head full of metal, a crazy artist for a guardian, and these weird blink stretches of half-remembered time when her mind seems to bleed into other lives. Then, for class, she writes White Space, a story about kids stranded in a spooky house during a blizzard. But this creates one more issue. White Space is nearly identical to an unfinished novel about characters who jump off pages into stories, but she's never seen that manuscript. No one has since the writer killed years ago, never completed the book, which means she's blinked into the head of a dead guy, or has she tripped into a nightmare of her own story? Because now Emma is trapped in a bizarre, fog-shrouded valley with other kids who have their own dark secrets and strange abilities. The question then becomes, is she real? Are the others? Or are they just characters who have all fallen between the lines into a white space? And can they escape before someone pins their end? And that is what had me intrigued for White Space, because it sounds super good and maybe a little bit up my alley. Alright, now we're going to be jumping right into November, so last month for what I got for books, which is another big stack. Some of them I've already talked about, so I'm just gonna hold up the book again and we're gonna move right along. And the first one is gonna be starting with The Guinevere Deception by Kristen White. It's a King Arthur retelling, and if you look at it naked, It looks super good. And why does somebody always got to text me when... Okay. Like I said, I'm not going to give... I was about to give a description for this book, but I forgot I did a mini a book haul for this one. And I did a mini book haul for... Winterwood by Shea Earnshaw, which I still need to read because it sounds super good, and the front and back are just gorgeous. I've seen the white edition to this one, and they're both so beautiful. I want the white copy so bad. Oh, someone send the white copy of this book my way. I'd love you forever. And then the other book I did talk about in the small November book haul was also Fireborn by Rosa Munda. This definitely sounds good, and it's got dragons. Today it begins. Today we will rise. Excited to get to that one. And then another book that I did talk about was The Name of All Things, which is the sequel to The Ruin of Kings. Just like, oh, look how gorgeous. Dragons. Alright, now let's get into the rest of the books in November that I haven't already talked about yet. As you all know, Supernova came out. It's a sequel to Renegades. Have I read Renegades? No. I have not. But do I have all the books now? Yes. Yes, I do. And I don't know why I'm like this, but I know I'm not the only one. So, yes. I will get to these books very soon. All I know is that it's about superheroes and they're amazing. And since this is the third book to Supernova, I'm not going to give a description about it because it's been floating around here on BookTube, but I will show my copy of like this. I'm like, because I'm a weirdo. And then I like that inside. That is pretty cool. And nothing on the front when you take the cover off. Kind of sad. Alright, moving on. The next book I did manage to pick up is Girls of Storm and Shadow by Natasha Nang, which I finally got around to reading Girls of Paper and Fire last month, and I really enjoyed it. Here's this one, and I painted my edges blue. Can you guys see that? That is so pretty. Ugh. Love the blue. I painted my first one pink, so I had to paint this one somewhat similar color to this one. Alright. The girls of Paper and Fire did the impossible. They escaped, but out in the unforgiving wild, hunted like animals, they discover the hate most of the terrifying prisons have no walls. To be free, they must destroy a king who refuses to die. A storm is coming. Lee is the moon chosen, the commoner who managed to do what no one else could. But confronting the cruel demon king wasn't the end of her story. It was just the beginning. Now Lee and her warrior love Ren must prepare for a revolution. Their journey is made even more treacherous by the heavy bounty on Lee's head, as well as insidious doubts and trauma that threaten to tear Lee and Ren apart from within. Meanwhile, a vengeful plot to acclimate the rebels is gaining strength. Powered by dark magic, will Lee success in her request to overthrow the Demon King and protect her love for Ren? Or will she fall victim to the sinister magic that seeks to destroy her. And that is Girls of Storm and Shadow. Like, the cover is just so gorgeous. Like, I can't. Alright, the next book I picked up, because I also have it on audio, and I heard Meg with Books talked about this book, and quite a few other people as well, and that is The Turn of the Key by Ruth Ware. And all I basically know about it is a nanny who went to go watch these kids, and the money sounded too good to be true, and she gets thrown in jail for a claim to killing a kid on her duty when she really did not. So, let's see if what I just said is correct. I'm hoping. When Rowan Kane stumbles across the ad, she's looking for something else completely. But it seems like too good an opportunity to miss. See, I was correct about that. A live-in nanny post with a straggly generous salary. And when she arrives at Heather Bear House, she is smitten by the luxurious smart home fitted out with all modern conveniences. La la la. By the beautiful Scottish Highlands and by this picture-perfect family. What she doesn't know is that she's stepping into a nightmare, one that will end with a child dead and herself in prison, waiting trial for murder. Writing to her lawyer from prison, she struggles to explain the unraveling events that led to her interaction. It wasn't just the constant surveillance from the cameras installed around the house or the malfunction technology that woke the household with the booming music or the turned lights off, wow, at the worst possible time. It just wasn't the girls, who turned out to be a far cry from the immaculately behaved model children she met at an interview. It wasn't even the way she was left alone for weeks at a time with no adults around apart from the dramatic handyman Jack Grant. It was everything. She knows she's made mistakes. She admits that she lied to obtain the post and that her behavior toward the children wasn't always ideal. She's not innocent by any means, but she's maintains she's not guilty, at least not of murderer, which means someone else is. And that is The Turn of the Key. I can't wait to get more into it. Right now I'm like 3% into it, so I can't wait to find out. This video is going to be ridiculously long. I apologize. But you knew what you were doing when you clicked on it, so thank you! Alright, the next book I'm going to talk about is Chrysaris War, One Mortal, One Maid, One Loved, One Betrayed. Now, this copy I found, I love it. It's blue. The original copy has like more rainbowish colors into it, and I found mine that way, and I found it signed. Like, how often do you find both of those combinations? Not very often. So, thank you to whoever gave this book up with it signed. I thank you. Alright. Impossible love between two girls, one human, one maid. A love that could birth a revolution. After the War of Kind ravaged the Kingdom of Avru, the Audio May, designed to be the playthings of royals, took over the estates of their owners and bent the human race to their will. Now, Alea, a human servant rising in the ranks of the House of the Sovereign, dreams of avenging the death of her family. by killing the souvenir's daughter, Lady Seer, who was made to be beautiful, to be flawless, and to take over the work of her father. Cersei had been preparing to do just that, to inherit her father's rule over the land, but that was before she was betrothed to Skyr Kinnoch? I have no idea. Who seems to have a thousand secrets. That was before she discovered her father isn't as benevolent as she thought. That was before she met Aelya. Set in a rich imagined fantasy world, Nina Valera's debut novel is a swimmingly romantic tale of love, loss, and revenge that grapples with what it really means to be human. And that is this beauty of a book. Why I said it like I did the way at the end. At this point, we just roll with it. Not quite done yet, though. Yeah, I'm sorry. The next book I am definitely going to talk about is The Queen of Nothing by Holly Black. This is the third book to the Cruel Prince series, and I've already finished it this month in December. Woohoo! I got the Barnes & Noble's edition, and on Y'all See the Snake? Oh, with the crown? Mm-hmm. I don't need to give a description for The Queen of Nothing because it's been floating around, and it's about Jude being exiled because that's what Cardian did to her, and it's just a wrap-up coming for this very, very soon because I need to spill some tea on this, okay? Not real tea, but the tea. We need to spill the tea. Okay, moving on. I don't know which books to grab. But I am going to grab I Hope You Get This Message by Farhana Rishi? I'm not even sure. But Mom, Dad, Sammy, Sean, I don't know if any of this is real, but just in case, I love you so much. I'm praying for your safety. Gee, I don't know where you are or if you even care to hear from me, but meeting you was the best thing that ever happened to me. Thank you. Jeff, I told you this would happen. I told you. Dear Taylor, I hope you get this message. Mom and I forgive you. We love you. We want you to come home. I like to read the back because that's just what I like to do. But 7 days, 7 days, the earth might end in 7 days. When news stations start reporting that the earth has been contacted by a planet named Alma, the world is abuzz with rumors that the alien entity is giving the civilization only a few days before they hit the kill switch. For high school tronc Jesse Hewitt, though, nothing has ever felt permanent. Not the guys he hooks up with, not the jobs his underpaid mom works so hard to hold down. Life has dealt him one bad blow after another, so what does it matter if it all ends now? Kate Collins, on the other hand, is desperate to use this time to find the father she's never met, the man she grew up hearing wild stories about, most of which she didn't believe. And then there's Edeem Cayan. While coding the computer programming has always come easily to him, forgiveness doesn't. He can't seem to forgive his sister for leaving, even though it's his last chance. With only 7 days to face the truth and right the wrongs, Jesse, Kate, and Adine's paths collide, excuse me, even as their worlds are pulled apart. And that is, I hope you get this message. And it sounds super good and intriguing, and it's got aliens, like, yes, we like some weird scientific stuff on this channel. And that is exactly how I'm saying that word, and we're leaving it off with that. Alright, the next this next book I'm gonna talk about, wow, I really said bull. We're gonna talk a little bit about The Toll by Neil Schusterman. I really need to read the first two books. Don't come at me. I will eventually get to them, I promise. But we're going to read a little bit of the back because I don't want to get spoiled from the front. So bear with me. Ark of a Scythe, Book 3. I am your competition. I am the last word of your unsatisfied, unsavory lives. I am your Your death is both my verdict upon you and my gift to you. Accept it with grace, and thus farewell. And that is all I am giving you for The Toll, because like I said, I haven't really read the first two, so I don't want to spoil myself. So you can forgive me for this one. But I had to get it because, again, I'm like that. They sound super good and something I would like, so. Now, this next book I'm going to talk about, I hope I really like this one because I didn't like the first book by this author. But I'm hoping to like The Starless Sea by Erin Morgenstern. She is the author who wrote The Night Circus. I did read that. Like I said, I didn't really like it. I mean, I liked some parts of it, but at the same time, I really didn't like it. But I'm gonna give this one a try just because, first off, look how freaking gorgeous that is. And the spine, and can we talk about those end papers? The end paper? It's pretty gorgeous. So, you know I had to buy into it. So, far beneath the surface of the earth, upon the shores of the Starless Sea, there is a labyrinth collection of tunnels and rooms filled with stories. Entranceways that lead to this sanctuary are often hidden, sometimes on the forest floors, sometimes in a private homes, sometimes in plain sight, but those who seek will find. Their doors have been waiting for them. Zachary Ezra Rollins is searching for his door. Though he doesn't know it, he follows a silent siren song in expectable certainty that he is meant for another place. When he discovers a mysterious book in the stacks of his campus library, he begins to read his entrance by tales of a lovelorn prisoners, lost cities, and nameless acolytes. Suddenly, a turn of the page brings Zachary to a story of his own childhood, and possibly written in this book that is older than he is. A bee, a key, and a sword emblazoned on the book lead Zachary to two people who will change the course of his life. Marybelle, a fierce pink-haired painter, and Dorian, a handsome barefoot man with shifting allisons. The strangers guide Zachary through a masquerade party, dances, and whispers of backroom stories to the headquarters of a secret society where doorknobs hang from ribbons, and finally through a door conjured from paint to the place he has always yearned for. Amid twisting tunnels filled with books, gilded ballrooms, wine-dark shores, Zachary falls into an intoxicating world soaked in romance and mystery, but a battle is raging over the fate of this place. And though there are those who would willingly sacrifice everything to protect it, there are just as many intent on destruction as Zachary and Maribel and Dorian venture deeper into the space in histories and myths and searching for answers in one another. A timeless love story unfolds, casting a spells of pirates, painters, lovers, liars, and ships that sail upon a starless sea. That sounds really good. Like, I'm intrigued more by this one than I was by the Night Circus. And that really says a lot, I think. And we'll be right back. Alright, we have a couple of books left from November book haul that I have yet to share. This video is already ridiculously long. I apologize, but I just got so many good books between October and November, and if this isn't the time to geek out about them, I don't know when is. But the next book I got, because I seen it, I think, on Goodreads and it sounded really good, which is The Blood Heir by Amelia Nguyen Sahu. I think a princess with a deadly gift, a calm man with no past and no future, an empire spiraling into chaos. It's time to choose a side, and that is Blood Heir. And that alone has me intrigued, and so does this cover. And it's got some kind of things on the front and the back, and the spine is black and gold. So so yes, and we're following a girl named Anna. And that's all I'm going to give you the details on this one. I'm sorry, I'm trying to cut it a little bit short, but it definitely sounds good. So definitely pick up Blood Heir. The next book I picked up is a book called Creep by Hiran Korang. I'm not even sure how to say that author's name. But their dream house has become a nightmare. Olivia is curious about the people moving into 16 Alt Place. The last family there moved out in the dead of the night, and the new family, the Donahues, has no idea why. Olivia becomes fast friends with Janie Donahue, so she's there at the house when the first letters arrive. I am the Sentry of Glenham Heights. Long ago, I claimed 16 Alt Place as a levy for my guardianship. The walls will not tolerate your trespass. The ceilings will bleed and the windows will shatter. If you do not cease your intrusion, the rooms will soon smell of corpses. Who is this century, and why does the century want the Donahues out of the house badly enough to kill? As Olivia and Janie explore the house, they find a number of sinister secrets, and as they explore their town, they find a hidden history that the century wants to remain hidden forever. You can lock the doors, you can close the windows, but you can't keep the century out. And that sounds super good and creepy, which is why it says creep, and then it also says below it, someone is watching. Like, that sounds super good. And then the last two I'm going to talk about, I'm not going to give another synopsis for, because they've been around forever. I've seen the movies to these books, I just haven't read them. But that is Harry Potter and the Half-Blood Prince, and then of course Harry Potter and the Deathly Hallows. So I have a whole series to these now, so I can definitely binge read whenever I want to, which I'm gonna start next year, starting with the first one and of course ending with book 7. So if I read it each month by my timing, maybe I can have this one done in July, if I'm good with it. We'll see how long they take me all, because book 5 through 7 are big beast books. We're not gonna lie, 4 through 7 are big beast books. The first three, they're quick and easy to smash through. 4 through 7, big masterpieces. Alright, and there you guys have it. That was my October/November book haul. Sorry this video is a little long. I'll try to edit it as much as I can. And if you're new here, go ahead and hit that subscription right down there. And hit the like bell, or hit the like bell. Hit the like button if you like the video, and hit the notification bell so you'll get an email from... for the next time I post videos, which I try to do frequently, and I'm also in the middle of doing Vlogmas as well, so they're coming eventually. The Vlogmas part 1 is still uploading, my internet kind of sucks, so hopefully they'll be up before New Year's Eve. Fingers crossed, we'll see. Anyway, I hope you guys are having a good day or night, and I will catch you in Vlogmas. Bye guys.